So my name is Antoine, I'm the cryptography lead at Climatix, and today I'm going to talk to you about VES, which is our work, ongoing work on integrating zero cash on Ethereum. So, well, I guess everyone here knows about Ethereum, and you guys know that the platform is amazing. We have this EVM, which is a very elegant execution environment, but the thing is, well, it's pretty bad for privacy, right? You can deploy smart contracts, but you need to pay for the gas, and so on and so forth. So, well, we thought about, okay, well, can we leverage this execution environment to actually do zero-knowledge state transitions, right? And many people have been talking about that throughout the conference. And basically the idea is, okay, well, we have like an encrypted state in some way, and we'd like to be able to prove in zero-knowledge that we end up in another state, which is also encrypted, like with encrypted data or permitted data. And we want to prove in zero-knowledge that we are not creating value in this state transition. So not double spending, not creating money out of thin air and so forth. This is going to be our goal throughout this talk. So, let's first recap briefly what is a proof system. So what is a proof? Well, a proof is just something that convinces someone that a statement is true. So, if I want you to prove to me that you have a phone, just show me your phone and, well, now I'm convinced. The problem is that now I can see actually that you have an iPhone and potentially I'm going to see a wallpaper and so forth. So I'm going to learn more information in the mix. So we're going to be interested in zero knowledge proof throughout this talk. And if you actually look into the literature, you may stumble upon the notion of a language. So you basically want to prove that X, which is some sort of like instance that belongs to a language. And this is equivalent to say that there exists a witness W such that X and W satisfy some binary relationship. So it's just like some formal jargon just to make sure we're all on the same page. It's not super important for the purpose of the talk. What is a proof system? So a proof system is just like a set of procedures which enable you to actually generate proofs and kind of like define the rules of acceptance for a proof and that should tell the verifier when to reject the proof. Again, this is pretty informal, but I just want to make sure we kind of understand the same jargon. And you have many different settings of interest when you talk about a proof system. So you can like be interested in having interactions back and forth with the prover. So as a verifier, you're going to ask a lot of questions to the prover, receive the answer, and then decide whether or not you want to accept the proof. Or maybe you don't want these kind of interactions to happen, and you just want the prover to send you a proof, and then do see whether you want to accept it by yourself or not. And you also have the zero knowledge property, which is basically showing that, well, as a prover, as a verifier, you know nothing except that my X belongs to the language. So I'm just proving to you that some condition holds, but I don't want to tell you about my private information. So what's very important to properly kind of understand these notions of proof systems is to understand that when we talk about proofs, we are not going to refer to traditional mathematical proofs. Like if I want to prove a theorem, then you need to check it. Like to check my proof line by line to make sure that I'm not violating any inference, rules in the inference process, right? I'm not dividing by zero and I'm not doing probabilistic stuff. But in the context of probabilistic proofs, we are basically going to use randomness to only check very few locations in the proof, and the proof system is going to ensure that the verifier is going to be tricked with very small probability. So it's going to be negligible in the security parameter, something along the lines of 1 divided by 2 to the 128. So it's just like 0, basically. Okay, so I'm not going to spend much time on this slide. Snarks have been talked through like a lot throughout the conference. But like the key takeaway is that, well, snarks are not perfect, but they are pretty good in the blockchain setting because they are very fast to verify. And in general, you want the verification to happen on-chain, not to violate the consensus rules. The proofs are pretty small. Again, in general, the proofs are going to be set up on-chain, so you'd better have them small, otherwise your blockchain storage is going to skyrocket. And they can support NP, meaning that you can basically prove whatever you want, quote unquote. But well, everything is not perfect. Like, there is nothing perfect in this world, and the ZK snarks have some drawbacks, one of which being that they are trapdoored, so you need to like generate this kind of toxic waste, which is quite a bit annoying, so you need to have an NPC to generate this common reference string thing and so on. And well, you have an SRS per relation, but your cluster is here because, well, like universal SRS snarks is a pretty active research area and people have been publishing Plum, Sonic, and Orbalite and all these things. So it looks like we're making tremendous progress in this area. But the thing is, well, the most efficient snark remains gross 16. And again, if you want to have very small proofs, very fast verification time, and so on and so forth, sometimes for very big statements, you just better stick to gross 16. Okay, so in general, when you want to use a snark, well, first you need to want what you want to prove. And then this, well, this is just an English statement, so I want to prove to you that I know the perimeter at Ash or something boring like that. The thing is, well, I mean, this is not very nice. I mean, you need to have an algebraic structure in order to be able to actually do your mathematical operation, to generate the proof and so on, right? To reason about it. So, basically what you need to do is to represent your proposition, so what you want to prove, as an arithmetic circuit, which is defined over a finite field. So, this is, like, I'm sure some of you guys are familiar with R1CS and all these things, and this is basically doing that, doing this kind of representation of your statement into algebraic constraints. And basically the idea is that you are going to reduce your problem into an instance of circuit SAT, which is an NP complete problem, so which represents the NP class. This is why I said SNARKs support NP. And the idea is going to show that you have this relation that holds on your X and W, so your public and your private input satisfy a binary relation. But what you want to make sure is that you only use your private information inside the circuit, and you don't want to say anything about the state of the internal state of the circuit. So this may seem a little bit abstract, but let's see this with an example. And please stick around, because this is a very packed slide and potentially a little bit overwhelming, but I'm not going to go through it. I mean, this is boring. I just want to convey the idea here. So let's first start by a statement. So I want to, well, as a prover, I want to prove that I know the root of a polynomial. Okay, just an arbitrary example. So, well, this is actually quite nice. My polynomial is public, so A, B, C, and D are the coefficients of my polynomial, and they are going to constitute like the input of my arithmetic circuit here. But of course, I don't want to tell you the root I know because maybe it took me ages to compute it, right? So what I'm going to do is, well, this arithmetic circuit is actually a representation of my statement, and I'm going to use my witness here, W, inside of my circuit. So basically, I'm going to fit my witness inside of my circuit to be able to compute, assign values to my input wires in my circuit and actually show that the output of the circuit is 1. So the key takeaway here is that in the zero knowledge setting, you don't want to, as a prover, you just want to tell about your public input, the topology of your circuit, which expresses the computation you want to generate a proof for, but you don't want to tell anything about the internal state of your circuit because it carries some information about your witness. And basically all the left-hand side of this slide, which is a little bit packed, is just showing that, well, this graphical representation of your arithmetic circuit can actually be represented as constraints, like this is equivalent, actually. And then you can massage a little bit this constraint system by using some vector notation and matrix notation to infinite check the satisfiability of all these constraints into a single check using matrix notation, right? So it's just like some massaging which is done. And at the end of the day, what matters, and I think this is what's important because people potentially tend not to focus on this while it's underpinning all the modern proof systems. At the end of the day, what the verifier is going to do is just verify some properties on polynomials. So whether you're interested in STARKs, in SNARKs, in whatever bulletproof or whatever, like all the like the mechanisms underpinning these proof systems is just about checking the relationship on polynomials. So now all this proof system is going to kind of be compiled down into a relationship into a set of conditions on polynomials, and you just want to make sure that the polynomials equal zero on a given domain. So this process is basically called arithmetization. Again, this is underpinning like modern general purpose proof system, and it, like in this process, basically the verifier is going to randomly query the prover's polynomial at some random places. And the reason why we want to do that is because we want to have succinctness, right? I just told you, we are not going to check the proofs line by line, but just at some random locations. So you need to make sure that you catch any mistakes done by the prover with overwhelming probability, right? And this is why polynomials are used in the first place, because they are beautiful error correcting codes. So in this setting, the verifier is going to query the polynomials of the prover at some random places and then decide whether or not to accept the proof. And because, because we're in the non-interactive setting, we need to have a way to actually encode the verifier queries, right? I mean, we don't want the verifier and the prover to communicate back and forth with each other. So all these queries are basically going to constitute the toxic waste, and they are going to be encoded in the SRS in the context of SNARKs. And you have some extra condition that needs to be satisfied to bound the soundness error and so on, but I'm not going to go into these details. It's going to be a topic for another day or for just outside the room and that. So with all this knowledge, let's go back to the initial problem. So what we wanted to have is we have some encrypted garbage here, a zero knowledge proof, and some other encrypted state here, and we wanted to show, okay, well, I've just done something that does not violate the root of the system, but believe me, I'm not creating value and so on. So now let's look under the hood and see what is this encrypted garbage. So what if this this encrypted thing is actually encrypting a pool of nodes? Like a node is just like a data structure, adding a value, a recipient, and many other attributes as you will. And what if my proof is actually proving that I own a node in this pool, so I am one of the recipient or one of the owner, and I'm deciding to spend it to create another node of the same value. But maybe I'm going to change the recipient, and if I do so, then I just do a payment, right? So this kind of IT is encapsulated by the Zero Cash protocol, which is a fantastic protocol, which has been released in 2014 by World Class Academics, and which aimed to present a decentralized anonymous payment scheme sitting on top of Bitcoin. And more importantly, like what makes Zero Cash so powerful is that this is kind of like the evolution of Zero Coin. In Zero Coin, you have like fixed denomination, but in the context of Zero Cash, you can actually spend a set of nodes and create another set of nodes and show that the sum of the values of this node you spent is equal to the sum of the values of the newly created node. And if you do that, then well, you might be realizing, well, this is kind of like enabling to do arbitrary denomination payments, right? I mean, I can do like in Bitcoin and like join two of my nodes to create another node of a higher value and potentially take some like pay me back the change or something like that. And now you actually end up with a very flexible solution to do like payments of arbitrary denomination. So you basically reduce the now your mixing system is as expressive as your underlying platform, which is not necessarily the case for the mixers designed in the fixed denomination setting. The only issue, if I can say it's an issue, of the Zero Cash protocol is that it introduced new payment semantics to communicate with the shielded pool, and this required an fork. So this is why Zcash, I assume, was actually created in the first place. Well, the good news is that no analysis was provided to integrate Zero Cash on Ethereum, and my colleague Mikhail and I decided to bridge this gap and actually do the analysis. Is Zero Cash a viable solution for privacy on Ethereum? The answer seems to be yes, and I'm going to run you through some of our reasoning. And what's pretty good is that, okay, we have this execution environment, which is the VM is Turing complete, so we can do whatever we want, basically. And, we need to pay for the gas to execute the state transition, that's for sure. But what's good is that we can encode payment semantics also. So we can just deploy and represent the shielded pool as a smart contract, and then we won't need to actually fork from Ethereum mainnet anymore, it's just going to be a smart contract. So it's actually pretty good news. And this is how it works. So the goal is to deploy a smart contract which is going to represent the shielded pool on chain. And we will be able to interact with this smart contract to actually like deposit some value, do some transfers, and actually do some risk pools. The only issue is that, well, when you hear about like the design of various mixers, in general they stick with the three functions, deposit, transfer, risk pools. But they actually leak a ton of information. I mean, if I see deposit 4, as an observer, I know you just deposited 4. I mean, I get exact information about what's going on. Well, in our case, what we decided to do is to add a single function on the mixer. So we followed the same approach as Zcash. We actually modified the statement which was used in Zcash prompt in order to have a single function on the shield pool, which is called mix. So whatever action you want to undertake on the shield pool, you're just going to call the mix function. So it's going to have a vin input, which is going to correspond to the public value you actually want to make enter the mix, vout some potential value that you want to retrieve out of the mix, and some commitments to actually represent the nodes that you want to actually spend inside the mixer. So what's really nice now is that if you, for instance, did a mix with a public value in of 4, then an observer cannot really know whether you're actually depositing 4 for yourself or whether you are depositing 4 and mixing it with some of the nodes you own on the mixer to pay someone else 8 or something like that. And because we support nodes of arbitrary value, if you deposit 4, no one knows whether you are creating a node of value 2 and 2 or a node of value 3.2 and 0.8. I mean, it's just knowledge that is just not given to the attacker, so we reduce the number of leakages by a lot, basically. And now you may be wondering, okay, well, that's perfect, but if Alice decides to pay Bob and creates a knot on the mixer on his behalf, so basically like destroy one of her nodes and create another one for Bob, then how is Bob supposed to be able to spend his note, right? Because Bob needs to get some information about the note. And well, that's true actually. We will need to have some communication between Alice and Bob, and you have two scenarios here. The first scenario is you do have chain communication and no problems whatsoever, but you need to have an extra infrastructure to be able to have like a communication channel between the sender and recipient. You need to make sure this one is secure and so on. So you need to have a little bit more infrastructure. In our case, we decided to go for an encrypted broadcast mechanism which leverages Ethereum events. So basically what Alice is going to do, Alice is going to encrypt the note which is dedicated to Bob, so all this data, with Bob's key, and add the ciphertext of this note as another attribute to the mix code. Now, the mixer is actually going to verify the zero knowledge proof. Is Alice actually not creating money, not spending a note twice and carrying it out to double spend? And is Alice basically respecting the rules of the system? If yes, the proof passes. And the mixer emits the event on the network. The thing is, okay, everyone is going to receive the ciphertext, but no one other than the recipient should be able to actually decrypt it. So you may be a little bit worried and say, well, wait a minute. What if a quantum attacker comes in and just breaks everything? Well, that's right. That's a legitimate concern. And, well, two answers to that. First off, you can just use a plausibly quantum secure encryption scheme, and then you're just done, and your threat just disappears. And the second solution, as I just said before, do a communication exchange. The thing is, if you follow, if you use this encrypted broadcast, now you gain some resistance against hardware failure, because if you consider all the communications to be carried out off-chain, then if your machine burns, you just lose your data and your funds are just lost. Well, in this scenario, you just need to have backup of your viewing key, and you just scan the chain again, try to decrypt all the ciphertext, and if you manage to decrypt them, they were supposed to be for you, and then you repopulate your wallet that way. So you have a pretty nice feature here. So something which is important to say, though, is that this does not provide anonymity, because we still need to pay for the gas of the state transition, right? As a sender, you still need to call the mix function, and well, you need to have a founded account here. And it's kind of like a well-known heuristic in the worst case scenario to assume that if your account is founded, then it's known by at least one person as soon as you're not a miner, and this person can be adversarial and just say to everyone the knowledge they have about you, and everyone knows you. So this is like a very adversarial setting. So you can distinguish between users who are using this and users of the network using this and those who are not. So if you're in a country that is prohibiting the use of privacy-enhancing technologies, for instance, this is pretty much an issue. So to study like various solutions for that, maybe you can use relay services. But in my personal opinion, this is not a very elegant solution. You need to have some mechanism against censorship resistance. So you need to have some incentive structure to incentivize relay and so on. But maybe one more viable solution is just to do some changes in the core protocol and potentially investigate an obstruction or something like that. So if anyone here is up to date with that, I'm more than happy to have a discussion about this. So what about the software? Like I'm running out of time, so I'm going to go quickly about that. So we just follow the separation of concern approach. Designing secure protocol is pretty hard, and doing secure implementation is even harder. Like there's a ton of things that can go wrong. So we decided to make sure to isolate the sensitive components to focus all our attention on that and so on. And basically, what's quite important is that our solution is client agnostic. So whether you're using Alice, whether you're using Git, whether you're using Parity or whatever, well, you can just use our solution. It's not integrating into client whatsoever. It's actually working on any blockchain which is equipped with a virtual machine which is as expressive as the one of Ethereum. And of course, well, it's already ready for its deployment. This is kind of like the architecture. I'm not going to go into the details because I'm genuinely running out of time. But, we can talk about that later. This is just like the architecture and the different components. So that is pretty much work in progress. We published a paper in April this year, so 6 months ago, with my colleague Mikael sitting here. Please consult the paper, but be aware that we are working on an implementation. And we've made a lot of optimization and security fixes. So now the implementation is not a perfect mapping of the paper anymore. We've made a ton of optimization and so on. So if you want to track the latest development, please consult the develop branch or the MPC branch on which we have implemented the MPC and on which we're still fixing a few things and so on. Like master is a little bit old because we need to pack everything into a release in a couple of weeks, a release for the POSA. All right, so I don't have time to go through that, but please don't use fixed denomination mixers. This is pretty bad and leaks a ton of information. And well, thanks for your attention. And if you have any questions, well, either we take them here, but I think I'm out of time, or maybe wait for me at the end of the room. Thanks.